good morning, everyone. Great to see you all here. Thanks for being with us at Gate City Baptist. We are glad to have you here. If you're joining us online, hi. I don't see too many yawns going on out there. Did you get them out of the way before you came in? All right. Kids Life will not meet this morning. Kids means you get to stay here and worship with your families. Parents, you're welcome. our Annie Armstrong missions offering continues this month with, remember, 100% of that money goes directly to the almost 3,000 missionary families throughout the United States and Canada. You can give online or you can give in person. If you're going to write a check, put Annie Armstrong on the check, or if you put it in an envelope, write Annie Armstrong on the envelope. Student weekend is coming up this week, and so be in prayer for the students and the chaperones that they will have a successful and meaningful experience. Speaking of experience, soup and chili. There's a soup and chili cook-off coming up this weekend on Saturday at noon. It costs $5 to attend unless you're bringing a soup or chili. Then you, it could be soup or chili, not super chili. It could be super chili. Sorry. If you're going to be bringing a soup or chili, talk to Frank or Debbie Harmon. Youth camp, there are apparently still some slots available for some of you youth that if you haven't been signed up yet, talk to mom and dad, parents, get them signed up. There's still spots available. You can register online. The egg hunt, our egg hunt is rapidly approaching. I put out, I think, 1,800 empty eggs, and you guys emptied the bucket, so I put another 600 or 800 in there. So thank you for doing that, and I'm thanking you in advance for bringing them back filled with candy. I figure we'll probably have between 2,000 and 3,000 eggs, so that should be plenty. So, and finally, if you have not filled out a Connect card, visitors, we would love to get to know a little bit more about you, and this is one of the ways that we do it. You could either fill this out and drop it in the offering on the way out, or you could go to gcbc.org/connect, right? Is that it? Slash connect? Mygcbc.org. Then you can find the online connection card. Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for today, and thank you for loving us in a way that we can barely comprehend. Your love for us is boundless and unconditional. And we are so grateful for that unconditional love because there's no way we could ever earn it on our own. I pray that we would always be aware of that love and to never, ever take it for granted. And now I pray that we would show our love for you during this time of praise and worship. We ask all this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning. So for our first song, Karen gave me a little information on it, so I went and did some digging on it to find out. Our first song, Come Christians Join to Sing, began as a Sunday school song for children. It was originally entitled Come Children Join to Sing. The hymn's name was changed when its author realized everyone loved to sing his hymn. It combines the praise of Alleluia, which is praise the Lord, with the jubilant assertion of Amen, which is how we end our prayers. This hymn resounds with praise for Christ our King. In Psalms 95, we read, Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. So now let's lift up our voices to the Lord in praise. Please stand and join us.
Christians join to sing, Alleluia, Amen. Loud praise to Christ we bring, Alleluia, Amen. Let all with heart
Good morning. I gotta tell you, I was a little overwhelmed just then as I'm singing the song, and I'm looking up here and I'm just realizing what God is doing. Let me just share a little bit, right? We have new people coming using their gifts. We got Vincent now playing on drums. We got Chris playing guitar. We got security back up and running. People are volunteering for that. God is doing so much. And then as we're singing that song, let me read a passage of scripture to you. It's Colossians 3:16. It says, "Let the word of Christ dwell richly among you, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another through psalms, hymns, and spiritual song, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts." So what he's saying is that we don't just learn from God's word as Pastor Michael preaches it, although that is definitely a time. But we're also learning, and we're to admonish one another through song. Do you know we just sang a catechism? It just hit me. That very first verse is what I've been teaching my kids using one of the resources we have out here, the New City Catechism. What is our only hope in life and death? That we are not our own, but we belong to God. That's what we just sung. It's really mind-blowing to see all the ways that God is moving in this church. And I am so incredibly grateful for them, for him. And to see how you are responding and using your gifts to serve, whether it's teaching. We had a new teacher teach in our Sunday school class today, and he did a wonderful job. And there's so many ways that you can serve God here. And as you do that, you grow. And so if you're not serving, let me just encourage you to be part of what God is doing here. I mean, it gives you joy. And as you step back and just realize what he's doing through you, it's amazing. It will allow us to continue to praise him for what he's doing. So where's God calling you? If you're already serving, thank you. Thank you, thank you. God is using you mightily. But if you're not, where might you be? We would love for God to continue to edify, to build up his church through you here. Let's go to the Lord right now in prayer and ask that. Father, you are amazing. What you're doing here is amazing. You have knitted this family together. Lord, you have brought us together, not by our works or by our efforts or by our wisdom, but by the blood of Christ. Lord, we've been washed clean and made new in Christ, and you have brought us together right here at Gate City Baptist Church to be your church, to do what you have called us to do, to serve using the gifts and the talents that you have given us. Lord, call us out, continue to call us out to use what you've given. Lord, not so that we might be lifted up, but so that you might be lifted up. Lord, we do this not for our own glory, but for yours. And Lord, it is evident that you are moving. We are grateful for you. Lord, continue to move. Continue to just call and use us, for it's a privilege. Lord, help us to remember that we are blessed to be a blessing, to serve others, and to bring them into the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Lord, use us. Call us. Help us all come to Jesus. It's in your holy name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Give me Jesus. I like that. Please stand. Join us as we continue to sing.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, ladies. You ever hear a statement, particularly one that has become almost cliche, and in truth, every culture around the world, and I suppose historically has had these, but the statements that get passed on and sometimes or with frequency repeated, and you wonder, who came up with that? For example, in fact, I used one of these last week. If it's raining while the sun is out, the devil's beating his wife. Who came up with that? In fact, everything about that statement is kind of puzzling because, I mean, first of all, when did the devil get married? I mean, was it in Georgia? I mean, because I know he went down there. Maybe that was to honeymoon. I don't know. And what does the rain and sun being out have to do with spousal abuse? I don't know. Somebody was the first to say that. I don't know who it was. Maybe you have heard this one. My mom used to, in fact, I'll say that in a minute. Anyway, my mom used to tell me when I was little, as I guess she was told when she was little, do not play with fire. Some of y'all heard that too? Yeah, because if you play with fire, you wet the bed. You didn't know that? So, well, now you do. And so some of you, now you're like, what is the reason? I played with fire. That was it. So like, for example, as a kid, I knew that, you know, if they were starting the charcoal grill, don't throw anything in there. My sister and I shouldn't play with that. Or if there's a campfire, don't be kind of playing around with that because, you know, you'll wet the bed. Who came up with that? I don't know. What about this one? If your ears are burning, then you have someone talking about you. You've heard that one, right? And likely there has been a time where, like, you'll see somebody sometimes, like the bottom of the earlobe will just be bright red. And sometimes you can even feel like your earlobe itself, for some reason, it's typically just one side at any given point, is just really warm or really hot. And you say, man, my ears are just hot. Well, somebody's talking about you. Somebody's talking about you. And you're like, well, who came up with that? As I was thinking through this, I realized my mother told me all of these things. And so my mother is not a truth teller, apparently. Anyway, because there's no truth in any of these things. And like, if your ears are hot, they're just hot. Nobody's talking about you. And if the sun is out and the rain is coming down, well, it has nothing to do with Satan and his wife. And these things are not true. They're not true. And maybe you've heard this one, though. There's no such thing as a stupid question. That's not true. Do you know who came up with that? I do. Somebody that asked stupid questions. And that they were trying to come up with cover. And so, no, there's no such thing as a stupid question. Now, whether or not you agree with that statement, I don't know. But this much I do believe we can agree on. All questions are not of the same gravity. All questions are not of the same gravity. Let me give you an example. Would you like paper or plastic? Compare that question to this one. Will you marry me? Very, very different questions. And they are different, not just because of what they're talking about, but they are different in terms of the gravity of consequence. All questions are not of the same gravity because the consequence is very different to the answer, will you marry me, or do you want paper or plastic? Let me give you another question that is of grave consequence. Who is Jesus? A lot of people may hear that, especially people out in culture, and think, well, you know, who is Jesus? I mean, who is Michael? Who is Robert? Who is, pick a name. It doesn't really make any difference, but this is a particularly, in fact, I can't think of a more important question. Who is Jesus? And that question is so important because of the consequence, because of the effect that your answer to that question actually has. But what? We're thinking about that as part today of a series where we're looking at some of the conversations that Jesus had with people in the Gospel of Luke. This is going to take us all the way up to Easter, but we're going to see a conversation that Jesus has with his disciples that really helps answer that question. What does my belief about who Jesus is, what does that affect? Look with me in your Bibles today to Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9. We're going to start reading with verse 18. We are told there that while Jesus was praying in private and his disciples were with him, he asked them, "Who do the crowd say that I am?" And they answered, "John the Baptist, others Elijah, still others that one of the ancient prophets has come back. But you," he asked them, "who do you say that I am?" Peter answered, "God's Messiah." But Jesus strictly warned and instructed them to tell this to no one, saying, "It is necessary that the Son of Man suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and scribes, be killed and raised the third day." And then he said to them all, "If anyone wants to follow after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life because of me will save it. For what does it benefit someone if he gains the whole world and yet loses or forfeits himself? Whoever is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his glory, and that of the Father and the holy angels. Truly, I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the kingdom of God." In this exchange, in this conversation that we kind of get to overhear as it's recorded for us, it really answers that question. What does my belief about Jesus, what effect does that actually have? Based on what we see here in this passage, based on this conversation, we see that it affects my understanding of his purpose. What I believe about Jesus is of great consequence because it affects my understanding of the purpose, why he even showed up, why he came, and what he was about. At this point in Luke's gospel, Jesus' ministry is getting into full swing, and he is increasing in terms of notoriety. And as Jesus is going from place to place, the crowds are really beginning to swell. In fact, as you see the beginning of this chapter, we're told that he's commissioned the 12. Word is spreading around about Jesus, and everybody everywhere is talking about Jesus, so much so even in verse 7 we see that Herod, the Roman governor, has heard about Jesus. So it's like word has gotten to the principal's office about this particular person, and he's wanting to know more about him. And then we see, starting in verse 10, that Jesus feeds at least 5,000. It's 5,000 men that were counted. So there's these thousands of people that Jesus miraculously feeds. And it's on the heels of that we read that Jesus had been praying in private, and the disciples were there. It doesn't seem like they were praying with him, but Jesus is away slightly from them, and he's praying. And then he asks this question, "Who do the crowds say that I am?" Now, this particular exchange is interesting because it is found both, not just in Luke, but also in Matthew and Mark. And in Greek and in English, you can see this, that the word that Luke uses here is different than Matthew and Mark. In Matthew and Mark, the question is, "Who do the people say that I am?" Jesus here in Luke says, "Who do the crowds say that I am?" And I actually believe that's of consequence, but we'll get to that in a moment. And so the disciples answer, "Hey, this is the stuff that we are hearing." In fact, again, coming on the heels of this miraculous feeding, it's likely that this is, as they're passing out the food, this is some of the stuff that they are hearing. Some say that you're John the Baptist, like a reincarnated John the Baptist. Or maybe it's Elijah who was transfigured to heaven, that he has come back. Or maybe it's one of the other prophets. All kinds of stuff that people are saying about you. In fact, these are the same things that Herod himself has heard, and he's trying to figure out exactly who and what Jesus is. Now, the question is, why would Jesus ask that question? Because if he is truly God the Son, did he not know what people were saying? I believe emphatically Jesus knew what was being said. He knew what was in the hearts and minds of people. But ultimately, this question was asked as a setup for the next question, which is this in verse 20. "How about you? Hey guys, disciples, you, who do you say that I am?" And Peter answers in verse 20. He says, "God's Messiah." Whether Peter answers that with his shoulders puffed back as though, you know, I'm the guy that knows the right answer or not, or maybe he said so with some measure of trepidation, we don't know. But there is translated God's Messiah. The word that she used is the Greek word Christos. It comes from and is the translation of a Hebrew word that gives us our word Messiah. And both Messiah and Christos, or Christ, mean the same thing. It means anointed one. And so he says, in response to Jesus' question, who do people say that I am? Who do you say that I am? And Peter says, you are God's anointed one. Now, as someone that had been steeped in Jewish tradition and culture and all the history of the Old Testament, they would have understood that there were anointings for three different types of functions. There was anointing for a prophet, there was anointing for a priest, and there would also be anointing as a king. And which exactly they have in mind seems to be kind of unclear. In fact, I believe what Jesus says on the heels of this statement, he says that he strictly warned and instructed them to tell this to no one. Why would Jesus want them to keep quiet? Because, I believe, Peter did not understand, as the rest of the disciples, they're still trying to figure this out. Though they have committed themselves to the task of following Jesus and being part of the team that is supporting him and doing some of his bidding and some of his work, they are still in the process of figuring out the answer to this question, who exactly is he? They think they have a concept, but it's not settled at this point. Now, the people of God at this point historically have been looking for God's anointed for a long time. It was back in 586 BC that the Babylonians conquered Israel. And after that time, the people of God had been looking for the day when someone sent by God would restore them back to a position of prominence and at the top of the pinnacle of the world stage, that somehow, some way, God's going to bring back somebody to bring Israel back. And they have been looking for this person for generations. They have been looking for this person for centuries. In fact, they believed, and as this whole concept of Messiah gets fleshed out over time, they are believing sincerely that God is going to raise up a new, even greater king than David. And there are statements like you read in Jeremiah 23 where God said that he would raise up from the line of David a righteous branch, a king who would reign wisely, administering justice and righteousness in the land. They heard those words, they were aware of those prophecies, and so they're thinking, whoever it is that shows up, whenever this person shows up, pow, pow. And finally, we're going to be Israel again. Finally, we're going to be respected again. Finally, we can throw off the oppression, not just of the Romans, but of the Babylonians, the Assyrians, everybody else that came in this line of succession of conquerors. We're going to kiss all of that goodbye, and finally, we're going to be our own people again, and we're going to have one that God has sent that's going to be in charge of all of us. Now, the fact that this understanding of Messiah comes about on the heels of the fall of the nation of Israel suggests and helps inform the notion in people's minds that the one who is coming, this anointed one, he's not going to come as a prophet because we don't need a prophet. He's not going to come as a priest because we've already got those. What we need is a king, a warring king who can establish us and restore Israel to its position of prominence. And Jesus says to the disciples, and specifically to Peter, who has just said, hey, you're God's anointed one. Don't say anything about this. I believe that Jesus says this because I don't believe Peter has in his mind yet straight what being God's anointed is. Because Jesus starts to clarify what that looks like. He says in verse 22, it's necessary that the Son of Man suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and scribes, be killed and raised on the third day. That's the summation of being God's anointed, to come and experience suffering, rejection, to give your life and experience a resurrection. And you ever heard somebody say, do he? But Peter, the disciples, I don't. That's why he's saying to them, I want you to keep this quiet because you don't get it yet. You think God's anointed means somebody coming here with a stack of horses and a lot of swords and spears and establishing a rightful throne for the nation of Israel again, throwing off Roman oppression and that of everybody else. And I'm telling you, it involves suffering, rejection, death, and resurrection. But they didn't get that. Why does all of this matter? Why is it of consequence who I think, or even at this point, who they thought Jesus was? Because who you think he is shapes very much why you think he came. Who you think he is determines and very much constrains why it is you believe he ever showed up then, what he's doing on the pages of history here. Who he is determines and shapes your sense of purpose. Because what you identify a person to be affects what you understand them to do. And if you're wrong about their identity, you know what you're also going to be wrong about? You're going to be wrong about their purpose. You're going to be wrong about their purpose. Let me go ahead and say what we all know to be true. The devil made the DMV. In fact, that's what the D stands for. And there's two types of DMV offices. You've got the license plate tag office, and then you've got the driver's license ID offices. And so all of these are managed by the state. And which one do you not want to go to? All of the above. Which one is the worst to go to? The one that you've got to go to today. Whichever that is, because they both stink. If you have ever been, and the only tag office that I have been to in Greensboro is the one over on Market Street. I don't know how the others are, but I'm telling you, I pay very, very, very careful attention when I go into that place. For one thing, because I am the nicest I am ever at the DMV. I mean, sugar wouldn't melt in my mouth. I am so sweet because I need whatever these angry, bitter people have to offer me. Anyway, but I'm very careful there because as you go in, there are these dividers, but the lines kind of overlap and there are signs up there. And there's two lines that interweave. One line is for title work. If you have just purchased a car, you need to get the title transferred to your name, get a plate, that type of thing. The other one is for plate renewal, plate surrender, plate registration stuff. And so when I get there, I look up at these signs, and I think very, very carefully. And then I get in my line, because I've seen this happen. They weave back and forth, and I've seen somebody get up to the front where somebody has called for renewals, and they get up there and they need something for title work. And you know what they're told? You're in the wrong line. The only thing worse than being at the DMV is being in the wrong line at the DMV. And the only thing waiting in a line at the DMV that's worse than that is waiting in a line twice at the DMV. And it all has to do with what you think that person, are they title work, or they registration work? And who you think they are affects what you think that they do. And if you're wrong about who you think they are, you'll be in the wrong line. You'll be in the wrong line. Unfortunately, there have been people for millennia now that have been in the wrong line. In fact, Jews from the 6th century BC until this very day have been mistaken about the identity of Jesus. And consequently, they are still in the wrong line, waiting because they believe that anointed one means that somebody that's coming is a king, somebody that's coming as a warring general. And Jesus says, no, that's not it. The anointed one of God comes to experience suffering, rejection, death, and resurrection. And this is a question of grave consequence. Who is he? Because it affects your understanding of his purpose. And if you're wrong about his identity, you'll be wrong about his purpose, and you'll be looking for the wrong thing. There's a second reason we see here that this is of such great consequence, and that's this. It affects how I respond to him. It affects how I respond to him. It seems clear that Jesus understood that the disciples and Peter, they were not clear exactly on who He was. And that's why he makes plain, starting in verse 21, actually in verse 22, the things that are required for the anointed one of God. And people are thinking, likely even the disciples were thinking, okay, Jesus as Messiah, Jesus as anointed one, Jesus as Christ means he's going to be this general, and I think that's his purpose in coming. And Jesus says, no, that's not the case. That's not why I am here. This is who I am. Who you think I am matters because of what you think I came to do, and what I came to do is different than what you were expecting. And this is of such great consequence because of what he says in verse 23. If anyone wants to follow after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. For, or because, whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life because of me will save it. Now, what in the world is all this losing life talk about? Well, first of all, when Jesus talks about losing life, I don't believe here he has in mind physical life. I think he's talking about the loss of the life of the person that you really are. And who you really are is a soul. And so many times we lose sight of this. And let me just make it very simple. I am not a body that has a soul. I am a soul that possesses for a period of time a body. The clearest way you can see this is to be at someone's bed when they die, or wherever they are when they die. And I have been there so many times, and you'll have someone who has just taken their last breath, and every piece of the body is still there. Heart, lungs, brain, stomach, toes, toenails, hair, everything is there. The hand that was held, the shoulder that was leaned on, the eyes that were, all of those parts are still there, but the person is gone. And Jesus says that what is at stake here is the loss of life or the loss of your soul. That's huge. That's of enormous consequence. And how you avoid losing that has everything to do with what you do with him. And that's why he says in verse 23, if anyone wants to follow after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. There is so much that Jesus is saying here that warrants extended explanation, and I wish I had a couple of hours and a marker board to unpack some of this. I simply don't, and you're probably grateful for that. But let me say this. Jesus wants me, he says, he wants his followers to deny themselves, to take up their cross. You're aware a cross is a means of execution. It is a tool, an instrument of death. Interestingly, though, there was no one, in fact, there is no historical record of anyone ever surviving a crucifixion. It had a 100% kill rate. You see, in this country, there are times that there are botched executions, or they can't find a vein, or something doesn't work. And even with electrocution, there have been some failed instances of execution, but there are no failed crucifixions. And so Jesus talks about crucifying yourself, taking your cross daily, and following him. Let me just paint the picture very briefly for you. Jesus is saying that what he is looking for are those that follow him to this degree. If it means that I have to say no to anything in order to do what he says, if I have to say no to anything that I might have otherwise wanted, if I have to say no to some of my dreams, if I have to say no to a person, I have to say no to an experience, I have to say no to some money, if I have to say no to something that prevents me from following him, what I will do is to deny myself. I say no to me, even if that means saying no to everything, to follow him. This cuts back to something that I said at the outset, that Luke uses an intentional word that's different from Matthew and Mark. When he asked the disciples, who do the crowds say that I am? And now he's switching to followers. Let me be very clear. It has always been the case that Jesus has been looking not for crowds, he's been looking for followers. There are stacks of, I believe, unfortunately, churches that are looking to increase crowds without looking to make followers. Jesus had 5,000 men that were miraculously fed at this lunch, and he's not interested in the thousands of people that say, hey, let me have another fish. Can I have some more bread? What he's looking for are those that say, you know what? I believe that you are special. I believe that you are one that's sent from God. I believe that you're one that I must follow if I don't want who I really am to be lost. But I'll follow you at what cost? Any cost. If that means that I have to say no to that job, then I say no to that job. If it means that I break up with that boyfriend, that girlfriend, then I break up with that boyfriend or that girlfriend. If that means that God wants me to have more kids or whatever it is, I'm telling you, whatever it is that he guides me to do, following him says, meaningfully following him says, whatever I have to say no to, I'm willing to do that because I know who he is. Let me make very plain what I'm saying here. If someone professes faith in Jesus, if someone says, I have a faith in Jesus, but that faith does not lead you to follow him, you do not have a faith that saves. Let me say it again. If you have a faith that does not follow Jesus, you do not have a faith that saves. Listen, Judas had a faith in Jesus. But when it came to the point where the rubber meets the road, whether I'm going to follow him, the answer was no. Judas had a faith in Jesus, but Judas is not going to be in heaven. Lucifer believes in Jesus. In fact, he more than knows that Jesus is, but he would not follow. He would not surrender. A faith that does not follow is a faith that does not save. The crowds had a concept of who Jesus was, but they were wrong about it. And this led them to a distorted sense of his purpose. When they were wrong about his purpose, they got it wrong about how they should respond. And because they were wrong about who he was and wrong about his purpose, that led some to say, well, he's just a lunatic weirdo with strange ideas, so I'm going to ignore him. There are some that said, oh, this is a guy that came as a fighter, and so I need to hang around for the fight. And when they discovered he's not getting ready to pick up a sword but lay his life down, they're like, no, thank you. But he was looking for people who would say, you're the one sent from God, and I will follow you. There were many that were part of the crowds, and Jesus wasn't looking for the crowds. It wasn't a numbers game. He's always been looking for people that follow him by faith, a faith that leads them to actually follow. John, our youngest, goes to preschool over at Pilot Elementary, and those of you who are parents in the public school system, you know what happens. I guess this is probably true at every school in the public system. Maybe it's just elementary, I'm not sure. But there is a phone tree message that goes out every Sunday night. About 7:30 or so, the phone. In fact, that's about the only call that rings on our landline. And we got caller ID, still have a landline. And 7:30, 7:45 tonight, I anticipate that phone is going to ring. And somebody in our house is going to pick it up. It could be me, it could be Caroline, it could be one of the other kids. And you'll pick it up, you'll say hello, and then you hear, this is Principal So-and-so at Pilot Elementary, blah, 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 blah. And I'm telling you, we never get past the hello before we click. Hang up. Hello, click. Why? Because I know every Sunday night we're going to get a message that is nothing more than announcements. And I'm telling you, those announcements never, ever, ever have anything to do with us. And so I see this call comes in. I know who it is. This is the principal on a phone tree message. And I believe the purpose in calling is to make what I think to be a worthless announcement, and that affects what I do. I hang up and I don't listen. Who you think Jesus is affects why you think he came and affects how it is that you respond. A lot of people, unfortunately, today, I believe, are hanging up on Jesus. They did it then. They're doing it today. I don't know if there is such a thing as a stupid question, but I do know this. There are questions of more grave consequence. But there is not a question of more grave consequence than this. Who is Jesus? Let me ask you today, as Jesus said, because it really doesn't make a difference what everybody else is saying, who do you, who have you said that he is? Because your answer to that affects what, why you think he came, and it affects, so far, what you've done. Will you bow your heads with me? We are asked a lot of questions in life, but there are no questions that are of any more importance than this one. I mean, will you marry me is a huge question, enormous consequence. Who is Jesus is of even more consequence. Because how you respond to that affects your soul. Who you really are and what happens to your soul when your time here is over. Whether it is one characterized by the experience of eternal life or eternal destruction. That's a big question. It's likely, thus far, you have answered to some degree that question, who is Jesus? But let me ask you, the manner in which you have asked that question, has it led you to follow him? I don't mean has it led you to show up to church. I don't mean has it prompted you to say the blessing. But has it led you to the point that you find yourself at crossroads of decision and you know that God is impressing on your heart to do X and your heart wants to do Y, but because you are following him, you say no to you because you're interested in saying yes to him and following him. Listen, I believe it's entirely possible that there are people in this room who have walked an aisle in the past, whose names are counted on the membership rolls of this or some other church. Maybe some who have been baptized. Maybe some that have a Bible that has their name impressed on it. Maybe John 3:16 is in your memory bank, but you do not follow Jesus. I'm telling you, it doesn't make a difference what you have done if you do not follow him. You do not have and have yet to experience a saving faith. This invitation is for you today. Who do you say that he is? You're watching online. What do you say? Listen, we would love to help you. This message is not intended whatsoever to shame you or to make you feel embarrassed or to prompt unnecessary discomfort, but to confront with truth that is of enormous consequence. Who do you say he is? What he's looking for is for you to say, I believe that you're the anointed one of God. You came to live, to die, to be victorious over death, and I want to follow you. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. If you want somebody to pray with you this morning, we'd be glad to. If you want to kneel at this altar and just talk to God, please do so. If you need to say something to him right where you are, if you have some questions and you need to flesh this out with a little bit more time, talk to me, talk to Jamie afterwards. But I'm telling you, there's nothing we ever talk about that's of any graver consequence than this. Who do you say that he is? Will you say, Jesus is the anointed one of God and I have decided to follow him? Lord, thank you for giving us record of this conversation that took place. You know, sometimes we get to overhear people talking in the store and restaurants, and they're talking about the basketball game from last night or the rainy weather we had yesterday, and things of personal interest but not of real concern, real importance, real consequence. You gave us an opportunity to hear a conversation that matters. It matters to the utmost level, and it posed your disciples then, as it poses us today, the question, who are you? Who are you? Because that shapes why we think you came and how we should respond. Lord, we're going to leave here in a few minutes, and as that happens, it'll be easy for us to compartmentalize and to put this away and say, check, did that, went to church, daylight savings, it was a little early, had to get up a little bit early this morning, didn't like that. Okay, what's happening Monday? What's happening Thursday? What's going to happen next week? But Lord, that soccer practice, that class project, that work assignment, that sales pitch, none of those things matter compared to the weight of the value of our soul. And what happens to that, what happens to who we really are, is shaped by how we answer who you are. So God, I pray that you will continue to speak to people's hearts. Help them to see how thus far truthfully they've answered, whether or not it truly means they are following you. After all, that's why you came. Thank you, Lord, for coming. Thank you, Lord, for giving us the opportunity to know you and to follow you, because it changes everything. We say this to you with our gratitude in Christ's name. Amen. Sincerely, thank you for being here today, and it is what I said in that prayer just a moment ago, the absolute truth. We want to help you in this, and if you have questions, if there's uncertainty, if there's this nagging in your spirit that does not go away, or just that you feel, talk to me, talk to Jamie afterwards, reach out to us if you're online. We want to help you with this, because nothing, I'm telling you, by comparison, nothing else truly matters. In fact, we've got reminders of that lately. I've been having to conduct a lot of funerals, and there are still more that are in the future. We're going to be having the service here on Tuesday for Bill Claffey. Bill was Gate City's first full-time pastor, and Bill passed away this past week, and his service is going to be here Tuesday. Visitation starts at 1, followed by the service at 2. And so please remember Jean and her family, also Ben Lunsford and his family. Ben lost his father on Thursday, Friday, I'm getting stuff discombobulated. That funeral is going to be coming up here, though, in a few weeks on the 23rd, let me see what I wrote it in, 23rd, it's on that Saturday, and so we'll be getting those details out as well. So please remember Ben and his family as well as they're mourning the passing of his father. Just a reminder that the funeral home business is recession-proof. It is. We better know who Jesus is. We can help you in that. We want to. If you're a guest, I'm glad that you are here. And if you didn't get a welcome packet on your way in, we'd love to make sure that you get one on your way out. I'll be at the doors at the rear of the sanctuary. And you look around, you see somebody that you don't know today, you shake their hand and say, I'm glad you're here. And you make it convincing, all right? I'm going to ask if you would to stand, and we're going to be dismissed in prayer. And then we're going to sing on our way out. Those of you on personnel, remember we meet today at 2 o'clock, 2 o'clock. Father, thank you for giving us an opportunity to meet together, to say through song what we believe, to hear from your word what should be the source of our real belief. But if there are any deficiencies in what we have said or what we have sung so that it does not translate itself into following you, I just pray, God, that you just gnaw at our hearts in ways that we can't stop feeling that, and lead us, convict us in such a way that we make the decision truly to be your follower, because it changes everything. It changes everything now, it changes everything for eternity, and we are so grateful that that's true. We say this with our gratitude in Christ's name. Amen.
Join us as we sing.